Okay, now we can see even higher hierarchy of the meter that's in four, right? So, da 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 da. All right, so meter is a framework of the beat unit, but now you can see that they are not in a surface rhythm explicitly. So the musical rhythm, listening or perception or memorizing them involves those motor circuitries that I just showed you. These are, these are two fMRI studies. Passive listening or listening with anticipation or actually tapping with your fingers activates almost the same premotor and the SMA area, also the cerebellum structure. This is another grid from Cambridge. You can see that similar structures are activated in hearing musical rhythms. So now we ask, can we capture more detailed brain processes with MEG and EEG with the higher temporal resolution? So we can make periodic stimulus like that, just metronomes. But what happens is that it will evoke periodic structure of neural response. So we don't know which one is physical parameters related and which one is internalized timing structure. So somehow giving these things literally doesn't give you the answer we're looking for. So I came up with the tricks. Bunch of clicks are presented, and then ask the listener to tap in group of two in one condition. So this is downbeat. We have the clicks. So that's what you're listening. And you're gonna go tap, 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 tap. Now stop. Tap again, tap, 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 and so on. You got it? All right, so this structure gives you the listening part that you're maintaining the mental grouping, okay? But listening to the same identical, physically identical clicks. But in your mind, it's engendered, which is the downbeat. The gray arrowed ones, these are the downbeat. Another condition is waltz condition. So the same structure of the clicks are presented, and then you tap every three, so tap. Tap, 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 stop. Tap again, tap, 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 and so on. Got it? Okay. So now, we don't want to look at motor-related brain activities. So I ignore this part of the segment. Now, I only want to analyze here what happens in your head while you're listening to the same identical clicks, okay? So now I can look at the one beat intervals that associated with the downbeat in march, upbeat in march, downbeat in waltz, or upbeat in waltz, okay? So this is all the same click. So you may think, well, you know, auditory evoked response, that would look all similar. What happened? But that's what we are after. All right, so we used the MEG source localization technique called beamforming, and it creates a sort of fMRI-like the activation pattern. That's the signal power here, and you can see left and right auditory cortex showing the auditory evoked response. Now, because this is a signal power, the normalized power trace here is all positive, not like your old friend P1, N1, P2, polarity reversal happens, okay? Nevertheless, you can see the dominant part of this activity concentrate around N1 time window. Does that make sense? Yeah? Now, we take the whole brain activity pattern and analyzed the trick called PLS. Basically, that's the principal component analysis so that we can maximize the contrast between the conditions. So now we put the down march, up march, down waltz, and up waltz, and then see how temporally correlated brain activity pattern makes condition contrast. The first latent variable explains 52% of the whole data set. And you can see the big contrast between down, march and waltz, okay? The second one, second latent variable, explains 30% of the data variance. So it's a lot. Then now you can see, well, march down and up didn't make too much difference, didn't contribute to this contrast. But down waltz and up waltz had an interesting contrast here, okay? So these are the significant components of the whole brain activity pattern. So now we look at the brain activation contrast between march and waltz. That's the first component. You can see that, You can see that the basal ganglia related places, close to insula, precentral gyrus, STG, MTG, and hippocampus, right hippocampus. All shows slight difference in the auditory evoked pattern. Contrast between waltz down and the waltz upbeat, that's the second component. Again, same place. But interestingly, left parahippocampal, right parahippocampal gyrus, they are active in differentiating waltz downbeat and waltz upbeat. So the sense of waltz, how to come to the waltz downbeat, is represented in the difference in those areas. When you look at these two, it's really interesting, especially in the right parahippocampal gyrus. The activity of auditory evoked response has very complex peak patterns. So they are somehow encoding where in the metric structure you are right now listening to this particular click. Okay, so this was my earlier part of my obsession of metronome study series. So I was pretty happy that memory system is contributing to the encoding of metric structure and anticipating next downbeat and upbeat structure. Next up, I proceeded to do switching. So let me show you this switching.
I like to be in America. Okay, by me in America. Everything free in America.
For a small fee in America.
Okay. Buying on credit is so nice.
One look at us and they charge twice.
I have my own washing machine.
So you heard this Bernstein's creation. This is called the hemiola. It's not Bernstein's creation per se. It's been around in the music quite widely in the Western tradition. Also, there are a lot in world music. Maybe Nori can talk about that too in the next talk. Anyway, so in hemiola, we're gonna switch. So down, up, down, up, down, up, down. In March, or up, down, the middle, up, down, the waltz structure switch back and forth. So first, you're going to go waltz, da, 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 da. Then you're going to switch, da, 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 da. Okay? So this is a hemiola structure. Now we call this switching point as pivot, okay? So my question is what happens in the brain activities on the pivot moment? Is this downbeat similar like this or this? Like it's switching here, so is it more like waltz? Or it's ending it's ending the waltz and starting the march. So which is which? And then this is upbeat. Is upbeat like waltz? So that's the question. So we're gonna take march, waltz, and hemiola. The paradigm is quite similar. The another condition that people were ask to tap 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2 pattern, then listen to the 12 clicks doing nothing, okay? So when we look at the auditory evoked pattern, auditory evoked response, and then this vertical bar characterizes the onset of the each click. And then this is a pivot point. Now I'm contrasting pivot down two and down two. Down two means down march. You can see they're pretty similar shape, but they're significantly different in the moment to moment. You can contrast the pivot down two and down three, meaning this is downbeat in waltz. They are also different. If we contrast march and waltz downbeat, yeah, that's basically the same from the previous paradigm. They are different. But you can notice that there are different time windows. They differ in the course of auditory evoked response. I analyze also the whole brain activity pattern. In a 100 millisecond time slices leading up to the pivot. So this is the previous beat And then almost 400 milliseconds later, you will hear the pivot downbeat. Now you can see the contrast pattern in a pivot up 3. They are pretty similar to the up 3 pattern. So they are still in a waltz mode. Then look what happens. The last 100 milliseconds, they just shift to the march pattern. So that's before the pivot. Now this is after the pivot. So this is a pivot downbeat. And then that shift continues. And it's totally in a different place, very independent from anywhere else. So I was really happy to see the hemiola has very unique signature in the auditory evoked response. We can visualize where these change happened, characterizing the pivot. These are, interestingly, many places that involves the motor-related systems. So even looking at the auditory evoked response simply, we can use the good advantage of the spatial information in MEG and look at what happens in the simplest click evoked potential. But what about other type of neural response? I've been talking about the evoked response. Evoked response, everybody knows probably. We have brain waves ongoing, stimulus onset coming here. We can average a lot of trials. Then when you average, we get phase locked response. That's the evoked response that we are always talking about. The data I showed you, it's all evoked response. But there are different kind of activities, maybe loosely time locked, but not precisely phase locked. So they will cancel out when you do the time average. These are called induced activities. And when you want to look at this, you have to do the time frequency analysis for each single trials, then average them. Okay, so these are the two types of analysis protocol to look at different parts of the neural responses. Okay, but it doesn't mean that they come from all different places. They are all initiated, originated, in the same neural structure, but we have different way to look at this. A number of research show that these are actually related. But for the sake of separating induced activities, we follow the typically used protocols. So we have single epochs. First, we make evoked response, subtract them from each one of the single epochs. Then we get this. Then we convert it to the spectral power, then average them. This is what you can see as an induced response. Typically, power increase from the baseline level is called event-related synchronization, or ERS. Power decrease is called ERD. So the auditory stimulus, when we look at the induced activities, in particular, not the evoked response we've been talking about, we can see this power spectra, spectrogram. Now, the warm color indexes the power increase. Blue color is power decrease. Now, you can notice that around 10 and 20 hertz alpha to beta band, it's massive ERD happening after the stimulus. It's really curious, but it follows totally the known characteristics of alpha and the beta band oscillatory activities in any modalities. Alpha and the beta are always ongoing, generated from ubiquitously in a neocortex, in a visual, somatosensory, motor areas. Then when something happens, sensory input, voluntary movement, they show the power decrease. So even you present just one click auditory stimulus, you can see the power decrease of alpha and the beta. Totally fits. Now, it's not my talk to cover all these things, but there are neural oscillatory structures identified across the brain, and they are different frequency bands. They're related to different kinds of sensory motor and cognitive functions. So you can look it up later if you're interested in, but I will say that neural responses reflect a combination of evoked and induced responses. And then there has been a debate about evoked activity. Where that comes from? Is that just a phase reset of the ongoing oscillation? Or is that additive, some kind of evoked response on top of it? So if you are interested in that debate, you should see this paper. Okay. So alpha and beta are interesting because it shows power decrease. But I'm particularly interested in the musical rhythm, its relationship to the beta power. Why? 20 hertz corresponds to the resonance frequency of basal ganglia thalamocortical circuit. It gives you all this neural signal pathways, and then it gives you about 50 milliseconds of time delay for the loop. So yeah, it creates 20 hertz. And we've been talking about this all the time for the musical rhythm. Now, beta band power is attenuated prior to or during movement and motor imagery. So if you are thinking about, oh, I'm moving my hand. Or imagine you are playing tennis in your head. And these leads to the beta ERD. Another thing interesting about the beta band is that Parkinson's disease patient show excessive beta band power in their basal ganglia, in their cerebellum, in their subthalamic nuclei. And they are associated with bradykinesia. They're freezing symptoms. They cannot initiate, for example, gait. Then that freeze symptom is ameliorated when you give them rhythmic auditory stimulation. they use quite extensively in the music therapy. Well, nobody knows how it works, why. So why not looking at beta band in the music rhythm listening? So that's what I did. We have fast stimulus, medium, slow, and random. And then you can look at this power increase and decrease, nicely synchronized with the stimulus in all tempi, except the random condition. So it looks like metronome listening, doing nothing else, just gives up and down of the beta band power. Now, this came from auditory cortex area. And we can look at the overall pattern of the beta band. It looks like the three tempi has similar power decrease slope, even including the random condition. But you can see the slope rising up is adjusted to the interval, to the next beat. So when you look at the latency structure, the slope down, the halfway here, it's lining up, the slope up, halfway the latency, that's nicely lined up, except the random condition. Now we can look at the brain areas that contributes to this beta up and down patterns. Of course, you can see bilateral auditory cortex area, but SMA, pre and post central gyrus, cerebellum, inferior frontal gyrus, more motor node participating in the beta band ERD when the rhythm is brisk. Then you can see the random condition, there's nothing more to talk about. So this is really interesting, because beta band had been associated with sensory motor functions, somatosensory system, even passive movement or motor imagery. These are related to beta band, and people are fascinated about that. But this added auditory time processing, auditory cortex as part of the beta network. Now we want to continue even more metronome stuff. So I want to recreate the march and waltz thing in a beta band. So what I did was, instead of tapping, ask them to listen to the slightly louder, softer version of that pairs in a march, or 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and so on. Then it stays unaccented, the same structure. You continue to hear the same physical identical clicks. But our hope is you're gonna maintain the metric mental representation. I can show you how it looks like in an auditory evoked response in the auditory cortical areas. You can see our dear old friend, P1, N1, and P2. It has a little different structure for the down and the upbeat, because it's a little louder tone here. Then you can see almost similar evoked response to the imagery part. But when we look at beta band, induced beta band, this is the onset of the upbeat. This is the onset of the downbeat in a perception condition. So the downbeat is slightly louder. So you can see more beta ERD here. You can see the trace of the beta average. But interestingly, in an imagery condition, the same structure persists. So that means your metric structure is internalized and the beta is responding to it. Does that make sense? So the beta band sounds like a lot going on these days. Many things are actually related to beta band. Posture control, movement, expecting cues to move, motor readiness. So many things are going to be superimposed in the resulting beta band observation. So we cannot really simply say, hey, you know, anticipation to the next beat is ERS, and stimulus processing is ERD. Like, we're very naive to say that in a 2012 paper, but that's really special case for the passive listening. This is really interesting paper from here. I think people have to attend to the regular visual stimuli, or they are forced to be accustomed to the offbeat visual stimulus. Now you can see the beta band rising. EIS pattern is different between on and offbeat attention. So again, beta band might be related to many things, but many things related to the task relevance and the anticipation or expectation or prediction of what's gonna happen next. So we did the follow-up study. Does this beta band pattern change when anticipating acceleration, deceleration of the beat before it happens? So in the music, you know when tempo retardans or accelerans. So the music comes to somewhere and you have this regular tempo. So you have the retardando, or you might be anticipating, oh, it's gonna go accelerando con fuoco and then go speeding up like a crazy. But what about this anticipation? Why are you still not hearing it? Is this related to beta band? So that's the question here. So now we set up the beat, the clicks coming in, it's always 600 millisecond intervals. And then you can look at the anticipation phase, like black symbols here. It's all the same isochronous beat, but people are told to anticipate speeding up. This gonna speed up. You don't know when. So there are some places that goes on, then speed up, or some happens quickly. Decelerate condition, they see the arrow cue, and then it's gonna slow down. So during this time, people anticipate, oh, it's gonna slow down, slow down, slow down. So can we see this in this beat interval? Look at this anticipation phase. Given that, they are asked to anticipate that difference. But again, this is identical beat structure, isochronous, physically identical condition. If we tell them outside of EEG gap, mix the trials and detect the temp change onset, yeah, they do better if that's cued. And reaction time, it's faster. So clearly, they are listening. They are successful in anticipating the upcoming tempo change because they can catch faster, right? Okay, but in EEG, we don't want the beta band contaminated with the motor response. So we had a dummy target and discard that trial. So this is not the task that they did during the EEG, okay? But the structure is same. Long story short, we looked at the auditory front central topography, and then this is the beta band power trace. Now the gray line is the steady condition. They were told there's no tempo change whatsoever. Relax. So you can see nice beta band ERD, quite similar to one of my studies before. But you can see the acceleration, blue line here, or deceleration, red line here. The ERD is much smaller. So anticipating something gonna happen will decrease the beta band ERD. It's quite nicely in line with other people's beta band studies when some cues, upcoming cues are uncertain, then beta ERD will decrease. We did another study out of this EEG data set. What happens after the sequence ended? The sequence, the speeding up or slowing down already happened. So if you are tracking this moment-to-moment different intervals, you might expect next beat position quite accurately, isn't it? So what happens when we looked at the place? If there was a next beat that was supposed to be, but there was no sound, so that's the silence. But are we able to catch any kind of brain response on that silent beat? So we can look at 450 or 800 and then 600 milliseconds after the last real beat. The real beat, we can see the beta ERD here. And the silent beat, this is a silent beat supposed to be onset. There's a beta ERD, but in very late latency. So that means it's not the repetition of the beta going up and down, and then lazily it can't stop itself, and it's entrained mechanically, so it just repeats itself one more time. It's not that, because it's different. And then when we look at the evoked response on that silent beat onset, the real beat evokes our dear old friend P1, N1, and P2 structure, but silent beat evokes P3A. So it's a kind of little surprise look how consistent the latency is. You remember that we are looking at totally different onset timing, but that's perfectly phase log to that time. So yeah, your brain is tracking and where the next beat is. And then, surprise, there was a silence. And interestingly, when we correlate P3 amplitude and the beta ERD magnitude, they're highly correlated. Okay, so beta band and then clicks, exploration continues. we did older folks with no piano experience, and I teach them 1 month piano lessons. And see before and after what happened to the beta band when they are listening to the metronome beat. So they came to listen and coordinate left and the right hand and learn how to read the notes, and we had a tremendous fun. very lovely experience. Then they have to endure lots of MEG mysterious experiments, 400, 800, and then 1200 millisecond beat. We replicated the overall beta band ERD, ERS structure in passive listening of those above 60-year-old folks. When we look at the, this is a very small cohort study, so yeah, it's very difficult to recruit people who are so dedicated to come to learn the piano 1 month. But you can see the piano training group had a larger post-intervention beta modulation amplitude. Actually, the non-training group went smaller. And then this beta modulation, because of the intervention, was accompanied with the improved finger tapping timing behavior. Now the beta band, again, this is an MEG study, so we can visualize what happens. There are lots of brain areas activated, participating in a beta ERD. A lot of frontal lobe. And then you can see the basal ganglia related places like caudate, thalamus, precentral, postcentral gyrus, and so on. But interestingly, there are kind of little involving even orbitofrontal, the ventral frontal prefrontal cortex. So somehow the reward and the motivation might be playing a role in the observed beta band change. Okay, so I think I have 5 minutes or something. 1 minute. Okay, so I think I could show you what happens quickly, and then if you're interested in, we can talk later. But this has been bothering us a lot. So you can see the auditory evoked response in a totally different levels, totally different magnitude. And then if you do the same click, periodic stimulus, it evokes all kinds of frequency component because of the waveforms. So, you know, when you have musical rhythms and a periodic stimulus, what does it all mean? You can change the SOA. But does it mean the response encode the tempo of the beat? It's quite difficult to dissociate what's going on physically and physiologically and psychologically. So now, if we look at the different frequency band, may acoustic beat out of two frequencies and a sweep up and down from 3 to 60 hertz, it actually forced the brain to oscillate in that periodicity. But the point was, even that forced periodicity involve gamma band, alpha and beta, and a theta band network very differently. Because if you look at the response amplitude and the beat frequency, if brain is just a black box getting response to the periodic stimuli like this, you should see only this line monotonically. But it's not what happened. You have a lot of harmonic frequencies component in the gamma band, and the alpha and the beta band are quite absent. And then our beat range in the theta band, they're quite enhanced. So the evoked response and the oscillatory network properties are not entirely independent, even in the forced periodic stimulation. So that's the final note. So I hope I did the good tour of the metric study journey with you. And if you have questions, please ask. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Fujioka, for this amazing presentation and the advances in the brain activities related to perceptions of time. We have a very short time to have one or two questions to keep the schedule going on, so please.
Thank you very much for an Can you hear me? Yes. Well, it was a very stimulating lecture and very, very interesting. Thank you very much. I know very little about brain studies, but I listened very carefully. But I do know something about committing sound to writing. Committing sound to writing. In short, I know quite a bit about the development of Western notation, of the notation. And many factors that you described can be real, have been realized between Italian and French notation, because French notation was over the bar line, there were no bar lines, and Italian notation was within the bar lines. But prior to this, there was also a development of what is called the ordinate, which was a larger structure, and you could manipulate what goes in between, even though the ordinate had the same time value. Now, all these factors that you describe, I can explain through eventually mixed notation that developed. Nothing of what you said is not incorporated in mixed notation. And this is a development that took place in the West. Nowhere else. There are other notations which do not incorporate these factors. Now, given that, my question is, your description of the beta band, the band. Okay, there is a place in the brain that we can correlate with rhythmic activities of all kinds. Now, my question is, who dictates what? Is, as you showed also with the piano thing, that you can stimulate the beta, you can change it. Now, my question is the fact that we do have a beta band that made it possible for us to develop the notation that we developed, including all the rhythms that they were able to structure, or is it that this was developed and we can show where it takes, where it resonates, where it exists in the brain? Is it the brain that accompanied all this development with all its the complications in the brain? Because the location is one thing, but the networking in the location is another thing. Now, who dictates what? Do we find what we did in the brain, or did the brain led the development?
I think our science doesn't have yet the methodology to answer your question yet. Because what we see in the brain activity is a consequence of our psychological processes, and it cannot be separated from what brain does. So brain supports our psychological processes, but then psychological processes cannot come without brain physiology. So I think this is like the main hardcore question of all cognitive neuroscience, I think. Yeah.
No, I think we'll take just one more short question, and I can promise you that the next paper is so much related and in a way addresses that question from a different perspective, so we can have a final discussion. So a very short question, if there is, or if you can hold it, and then at the end you can join us too. Can you hold it? Okay, so please ask the question. No, that's okay.
Again, thank you for the wonderful talk and very interesting. A great number of the people here in the audience are music educators, and we are practitioners by nature. So the ideas of beat and meter and waltz and march and hemiola are part and parcel of our work. I'm not asking like Professor Katz who dictates what, but I do ask about the practical implications. You refer to the Parkinson's disease. You also referred to music therapy, and you referred also to music pedagogy. So I wonder if there are more implications, I mean, in the practice, maybe in other fields, not only in music therapy and not only in piano pedagogy, but other fields of knowledge.
One thing that I didn't mention is rhythm and motion are really in music. Rhythm and motion in music are related to the social functions and then group activities and then bonding experience. So besides music education and the therapy application perspective, there are people who are interested in the research doing how the social cognition is related to music rhythm productions and experiences.
Okay, thank you very much. And we'll call to our next paper. Dr. Nori Jacobi,